We have been connected to the transition currencies in the UK as well. We provided the technical systems behind the pound and the bricks and pound. I'm not going to speak about it, but I love this picture. I'm going to speak very shortly about the enormous problems that we have on our planet. I'm not certain if this is addressed already, but we have climate change. It's totally out of hand. We have a graying and aging society, basically in big, huge parts of the world, including in Europe. But think about China. One-child policy for a long period, they will have an aging society which is almost non-solvable for them. We will have robotics and automation which will take away a lot of the jobs in the coming years. I can give you a lot of research on that. Most of you already know this. The question is, where are we able to solve these type of issues and how do we do that? Because we know that it's almost impossible to solve these problems on the global level. We have the Treaty of Paris. We are not able, at least, to get the US in, which is the biggest CO2 polluter in the world. A lot of governments choose for more local or more nationalistic ways, approaches. We have the Brexit, we have Putin, we have Erdogan, and I think even this country has its fair share of new politics. So the question is, how do we do this? We could raise taxes. If we raise taxes, we could give subsidies so everybody becomes climate neutral in its houses, or all transport becomes electrical, or whatever. The thing is that the moment we try to raise taxes, you get a lot of challenges. People don't like it anymore. Governments don't like it anymore. We want to be competitive in a global world. If you want to be competitive in a global world, you can't raise taxes. You need to lower them all the time. In the Netherlands, company taxes will go under 20%. We will be the lowest in Europe almost. And we do this to attract very large companies, so they are in our country and not in yours. This race to the bottom is not very healthy. What we think is that the battle will be in the cities. The battle is in the cities. Already more people live in cities than in villages and the countryside, and this will go up. In 2030, 60% of all people will live in a city. That's more than 6 billion people. So if we want to solve it in a city, how do we do that exactly? And we suggest that we are going to use digital currencies in these cities, which are trying to capture a big part of that economy in that city and which are leading this whole city into sustainability. Now, this is not easy at all. But let's say there's a lot of experience, there's a lot of books, there's a lot of theory here. There are already more than 10,000 currencies out there currently working at this very moment. I'm going to give you an example of some of them, but this is the only real chart I have, the rest of the pictures. Bitcoin and crypto, around 25%. We know there are around 750, 800 active blockchain currencies, cryptocurrencies, and this will go up because it's a very nice technique. It's very available for a lot of groups, and we will see a whole generation of currencies like this. We also have the LETs and the time banks. Do you know what it is, LETs of time banks? Who knows what it is? When I was 27, I became member of the LET scheme in the city of Amsterdam. And LET scheme is nothing more than a club. And we could start a club as we are here. And we all list our offers on an electronical or even in a leaflet, but most of the time on a website. And we are able to buy and to sell products from each other. One of the things that we did, we organized a huge party for a wheelchaired friend of mine. She's called Francine. She gained 30 and she wanted to have a big party, but she didn't have the money. So we chipped in our local currency and we hired catering services. We hired a neighborhood center, we hired a photographer, we hired a DJ, and we gave her the best party ever in her life. And we did this without spending €1. That's what currencies can do. LETs and time banks, there are more than 5,000 of them, this group alone. Local loyalty, you know them. This is a loyalty card you have from your supermarket or whatever, or your air miles or whatever. We have the gaming currencies, a lot of them. We think it's more than 1,500. You can't see what's here. This is barter schemes. If we speak about economy, barter schemes are the big thing. More than 60 billion euros per year is traded within barter schemes. And barter schemes is nothing more than a B2B network where they use their own credits to pay each other. Very efficient, very popular. Then we have the national currencies, 167. There are not more than that. And this is the small area where we are active. These are professional run currencies in cities that are trying to create a greener city, a more inclusive city, or a more prosperous city, or all of them. I'm going to give you one example. And something weird happens with my, that's a pity. All right, this should be nicer than it is. So we have a conversion problem. These are residents in a certain city, and these people, they buy in local shops. So this is shops, restaurants, at everywhere, around 50 of them. Every time they bring euros and they get a product, they also get a certain percentage of their sale in the local currency. This is the same almost as a loyalty scheme. So say the average is around 5 to 10% in each of the shops. They also get points if they do something for a public institution. So the municipality gives groups of kids that clean parks the local currency. The elderly care center gives family members points if they are in the family center in around rush time. So typically around in between 5 and 7 when people eat, if you have a group of elder people, you have one professional in this group, it becomes quite difficult to do this, because if this old man pees in his pants, then the nurse goes with this old person to his room to clean him, but the rest of the people are still sitting there. And you need some support there. So this is where we use family members. So family members come in to support the group. Last example is the social housing corporation that incentivizes people to pay the rent in time or to solve problems in the neighborhood. So what can people do with these points? So point number one is they are obliged to donate 20 to 100% of all the points that they get to a local club that they choose. This can be the football club, it can be the knitting club, it can be the church. We don't choose at all what it is, as long as it's not a commercial, it doesn't have a commercial focus. The average, by the way, is 40%. So 40% of all the points that they get from shops and institutions is donated. They can also decide to use it peer-to-peer. That means that the points that you have, you can use it to buy something from a neighbor or a friend or somebody else that you know. And we have a marketplace where all these ads are visible. Both the citizens, residents, and the social clubs can spend them again in the shops. This only works if the shops that get these points are the same as the ones that give them away. And there are several ways of organizing this, and we decided to do this by using invoicing. Basically, organizations here, can I do this? Yeah. They pay for every point that they have, so we can give the money back to the ones that receive it. This is a very simple model. We're going to extend this model in the coming years, because you can add B2B transactions, and you can add several other elements to this whole system. At the moment, we have 8,000 citizens, 15,000 monthly transactions. This is a little more, I think, at the moment. We have 3 institutions, public institutions, 50 shops, and 30 charities. And this is done in a place that is bigger than Devon. It's around 100,000 people live in this area. So we have around 12% of the population, or, if you say it like that, 25% of the households. Most of the people, and this is for us a complexity, most of the people are 60 plus. So the majority is 60 plus, which is very different than the programs that we did in Bristol and in Brixton, where the average age was much, much younger. This also means that people can't use or don't want to use smartphones. This is why we have an app. And besides the app, we also have a card. And with the card, you can pay at the desk using a terminal. That's the workaround. We still prefer apps because in an app I'm able to communicate in a much deeper way with the user. Because in an app I can send people a notification saying, hey, I know you always buy this, why don't you buy that? We know that one. Or if you walk in a certain street with some of your friends and there is a lady here that just bought a bed but she doesn't know how to screw it. How do you call this? How to dismantle, the other way around. Assemble it, how to disassemble it. We can ask 3 guys that live in her street to go to her and to help her. just with a pop-up saying, are you willing to help this lady with a bet? Yes, no, or never. And if you click on yes, you're the first one, you're brought into contact and you can do that. These type of things. I can't do that if I have a paper currency, which is a problem, we think. If you are considering of doing this yourself, we think then that this is a super great idea. We think we are on the fringe of a lot of experimentation in this field, but you have to do it right. And one of the things that we learned is that people are only motivated to do things if you have a combination of an intrinsic and an extrinsic motivator. The extrinsic motivator is clear. You can see that here. You have a carrot. I give you something if you do something back for your community, if you clean the park, if you lower your CO2 emissions, if you choose for biking, etc. The intrinsic motivation is that people become part of a bigger thing, of solving the challenges in your community. We call this an epic meaning. You are the prince on the horse and you're going to save the planet, and you are also allowed to kiss the princess at the end. So you play your real role in the community because you make the difference. By buying, by shopping, you change the community. By paying your rent in time, stupid example, by doing voluntary work, by cleaning the park, you make the community a better place. The second big thing is that you need a sound business plan. One of the challenges of the transition currencies is that there was no sound business plan. And this is also true for most of the do-it-yourself currencies that you find in continental Europe, including here in Austria. And that's a big problem. That means that you have volunteers and they work for nothing. The moment you start to pay them in your own currency, you get a deficit. This is tricky. Or you're depending on subsidies. And I can tell you, we did a lot of huge projects where we were totally depending on subsidies. We found out how you get European funding, so we did this several times. The thing is that most of the currencies don't survive a European project because after the European project, your business model didn't kick in. And that means that you have to go for new subsidies. This is why Bristol Pound is not life anymore, which is, I think, a real pity. This is one of the David Bowie. So it's super important to have a sound business model. And this also means that the sequence in how you do things needs to be right. And also your governance structure needs to be right. You need to make sure that commercial players, public players, and community groups are all together in this whole field, and that they are collectively taking responsibility to do this for several years. And in these years, you need to make sure that your business model kicks in. Last thing, which becomes more and more important, when we started in 1993, nobody cared about impact. That means everybody knew you did it for the impact, but if we have a nice story, we could sell it to groups, to peoples, to municipalities easily. Nowadays, they want to have proof. So it's important that you prove that people become less lonely. It's very important that you prove that it's cleaner in the parks. And that means you need to have a built-in mechanism to measure impact. Since we have a currency and we note all the transactions, we have a lot of data. And this is a very rich source for scientists. So it's also, I ask a scientist to come up with better frameworks to measure impact of these systems where they know that we have a lot of data because everything is stored in our databases. If you like this a lot, then I think you should read a book. There are a lot of books out there. This book is slightly dated, but it's the best book at this moment on the market if you want to know more about it. It's pretty grassroots, but it has the public angle and the commercial angle. You can find it on the coin.com, doin.org, doin.com. Coin is Q-O-I-N, by the way, website and the publications. And it's free to download. So please do it. Thank you.